I want to share with you this morning from Paul's letter to the Romans, from Romans chapter 5. I'm sure that for many of you it may be a familiar passage, but every time I get into a kind of a situation where things are going not as they should go, or I think they should go better, I always come back to the gospel. And in Romans chapter 1 verse 16, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. If we could put it another way, what he's actually saying is, I'm proud of the gospel. I love the gospel because it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew and to the Greek as well. And that's what Paul's way of saying that God's gospel, his good news, includes everybody who would come to it. Then in the first three chapters, Paul tells us why the gospel is necessary. And his bottom line is that for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And he divides humanity into three groups, into depraved society, who do things just according to their own way. Then he divides them into what we call moralizers, people who say they have standards and values but don't live up to them. And then the third group that he speaks about is religious people. And he says all of us are guilty and deserve God's judgment. And then from chapter 3 verse 21, Paul tells us that against this background, when we couldn't save ourselves, God has done something. He has sent the Lord Jesus Christ to bear our sin, and therefore we could be declared not guilty, justified, on the basis of the work that Jesus did on the cross of Calvary when he died in our place, taking our sins for him. And then chapter 3 verse 21 to chapter 4 describes what we call the way of salvation, justification by faith through grace alone. Now we come to chapter 5, and Paul begins to tell us some of the wonderful blessings of the gospel. One of them, the tremendous things of the gospel that causes us to say, I'm not ashamed, I love the gospel, I'm proud of the gospel. And so Paul says in chapter 5, from verse 1 onwards, he says, therefore, having been justified by faith. And then, of course, when you read therefore in the Bible, you must ask what it's there for. It connects what he has just said with what he's going to say now. All right? And he refers back to this whole way of salvation that God has so wonderfully and graciously supplied to us in Jesus. Having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have obtained our introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we exult, some translations say we rejoice, in hope of the glory of God. And not only this, but we also exult or rejoice in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation brings about perseverance, and perseverance proven character, and proven character hope, and hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who is given to us. For while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for the good man someone would dare even to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved through the wrath of God, from the wrath of God through him. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only this, but we also exult or rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. Three times, four times, Paul uses the term exalt or rejoice in this passage that we've just read together. And you know, folks, the Bible, and I'm probably going to rattle somebody's cage now, the Bible never calls us to be happy. But it does call us to rejoice. And there is a difference between happiness and rejoicing. You see, if our happenings happen to happen the way we want them to happen, then we're happy, right? And if our happenings don't happen to happen the way we want them to happen, we become unhappy. But God hasn't called us to happiness, but He has called us to joy. And one of the blessings of the gospel is this state of being, this condition of being joyful, of having joy. Because our life doesn't always go smoothly, does it? There are always bumps in the road. Even God's choicest servants have never had all their circumstances and the events happen the way they would like them to have happened. Take your servant Job, God's servant Job, or Joseph, or his prophets. Take the Apostle Paul himself in his ministry. But above all, look at Jesus, the Son of God, perfect. But things didn't always go right. And in this passage, Paul tells us that the gospel gives us a number of reasons to rejoice, to have joy. And to have joy is to be in a situation where there is contentment and there is absolute trust in God, where there is faith in God. And let me say immediately, folks, faith is not the ability to manipulate God into doing something He's reluctant to do in the first place. Faith is the abandonment of our lives into God's hands, trusting Him that no matter what happens, God is faithful and God is good. And in this passage, these first 11 verses of Romans 5, Paul tells us a number of reasons why we as believers, followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, those who've been saved, why we can rejoice. First of all, he tells us we can rejoice because of our spiritual position. He says, look at, and I encourage you to look at the scriptures with me. He says we can rejoice in our spiritual position. First of all, he says we have been justified by faith. That simply means God, despite our obvious sin and the evidence against us, has found us or declared us to be not guilty. On the basis that the Lord Jesus had died upon the cross, taking our place in God's wrath and bearing our sin and our shame, we have been declared not guilty. That simply means my past is taken care of. When I stand before the judgment seat of Christ, God will say that I'm not guilty. Not because I didn't do anything wrong, but because Jesus paid the sentence, because He paid the price. And therefore legally, because this is a legal term, legally the judge has declared me to be not guilty. That's my spiritual position. It means my past has been taken care of. my sins are forgiven. And not only does it mean that God is taking care of my past and taking care of my sins, but He is what we call in theology imputed to us the righteousness of Christ. Not only has He forgiven us our sins and taken it away, but He has given us the righteousness of Jesus. And that's what is involved in being justified. I have my sinful life dealt with, covered by the blood of Jesus, and I receive the righteousness of Christ. I want to illustrate that this way. We are actually sitting around, I remember seeing this last time, we're sitting in a classroom that seems to teach you accounting. Okay? In accounting you have debits and credits. Alright, I'm going to give you a basic bookkeeping lesson now. In God's general ledger, in His book of accounts, there is an account that has my name on it. The account of Emil Monarin. And down the debit side is the sum total of all my sin and my wrong, of all the debt that I owe to God. Also in God's book of account, there is a ledger account called the account of Jesus Christ. And down the credit side is the sum total of the righteousness and perfection of Jesus. And when God forgave my sin, He did a bookkeeping accounting entry. He transferred all my sin over to the account of Jesus. But He didn't stop there. He transferred all the righteousness of Christ to my account. That's what it means to be justified by faith. And Paul says our spiritual position is that we've been justified by faith, and therefore consequently we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And in this context, and if you go down to verse 10, you'll see Paul says, if while we were enemies. So when Paul uses this term peace here, he says one of the blessings of the gospel is that God has declared us not guilty, He has given us the righteousness of Christ, and we are no longer at war with God. Because when we were sinners, we were at war with Him. We were, as Paul says in verse 10, we were enemies. And so Paul says, our spiritual position is that we have been justified, declared not guilty, and we have peace with God. I'm no longer God's enemy because of what Jesus did. Whereas before I was. And any sinner is someone who is an enemy of God. He has declared war against God. He has joined forces with Satan against God. When we are saved, we are now at peace with God. Not only are we justified, declared not guilty, not only do we have peace, but Paul says here, we stand in grace. Now, if my understanding is correctly, the area in which we are now is Nürnberg. Is that right? Okay. I'm standing in Nürnberg now. Under me is Nürnberg, around me is Nürnberg, over me is Nürnberg. I'm enjoying all the blessings that Nürnberg can give me at this point in time. Beautiful sunshine, nice cool breeze. I'm enjoying that. And this is what Paul is communicating to us, that when we become saved, when we become Christians and followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are not only declared not guilty, we are not only at peace with God, but we stand in grace. Under us is the grace of God. Around us is the grace of God. Over us is the grace of God. We are receiving the benefits and the blessings of the grace of God. And I'm sure you will remember from any Sunday school training that you've received what grace is. Grace, G-R-A-C-E, is God's riches at Christ's expense. It is God giving to us that which we don't deserve. And no matter where we go, no matter what the circumstances are, no matter what the pressures are, Paul says we stand in grace. Constantly, all the time, around us are the benefits of God's riches in Christ. So we rejoice in our spiritual position. Amen? Do you know that as you experience? I'm not asking if you know that academically or theologically. Do you know that as you experience? So that you can say to anybody, anywhere, under any circumstances, I am not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God to everyone who believes. But Paul doesn't only say we rejoice in our spiritual position, being justified, having peace, standing in grace. But at the end of verse 2, he says we rejoice in our future prospects. Now, if you look at the scripture, you might say, now, Pastor, where did you get that from? But look at the end of verse 2. He says we exalt or we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Right throughout the New Testament, that phrase, the hope of the glory of God, refers to the time when Jesus will return as Lord and Savior, King of Kings, and we will spend forever with Him. It refers to the future. So God isn't only taking care of my past through the gospel, He has assured me of my future. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in me, believe also in God. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you, so that where I am, you may be also. And part of the promise of the gospel is that God will not only deal with our past, but He'll get us to heaven. He'll get us to that place where we will live and with Jesus forever and see Him face to face and worship Him and glorify Him. And that's important for us to understand, because sometimes, folks, we become so intense about now and this world in which we live in. John MacArthur wrote a book, said, whatever happened to heaven? But God has promised that He has a future for us. It's called the hope. Hope means overwhelming confidence of the glory of God. And the wonderful thing is the gospel says that when I get there, I'm going to be fit for heaven. I don't know how. If I look at my life and I see the stupid things that I decide and the things I do and the attitudes I have, I wonder how I'm ever going to be fit for heaven. But He promised. He promised. So I rejoice in my future prospects. I know heaven is coming. I know because of Jesus, God will allow me to enter in because He's declared me not guilty. And so this world doesn't become such an overwhelming issue for me. I'm very perturbed that I see many Christians anxious, just doing desperately everything they can to live now, when Jesus has already promised. But thirdly, Paul says, we not only this, verse 3, but we rejoice in our tribulations. In other words, he says, we as followers of Christ don't only rejoice because of our spiritual position, our past has been taken care of. We don't only rejoice because of our future prospects, but we rejoice in our present tribulations. Hold on now, Pastor. I'm cool with my past being taken care of. I'm very happy I'm going to heaven. But rejoicing in my current situation, rejoicing in my current circumstances, when everything is going wrong, the relationships are breaking up, I'm fighting to survive financially, how can I rejoice? But Paul says we rejoice in our present tribulations. That Jesus isn't only there to take care of our past and he's waiting for us in the future, but he's with us in our present circumstances. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And that valley has many paths, a different path for each one of us, but it has the same presence. And so Paul goes on to say, not only this, but we exult in our tribulations. When last did you thank God and rejoice in your difficulties? Thank you, Lord, that I've got a terrible boss. Okay? But what does Paul say? He says that tribulation brings about perseverance. The word perseverance means the ability to abide under pressure. When things go wrong with me, Paul says, I rejoice in that because Jesus is present, and I know that whatever is happening has a purpose and a plan. And the purpose is for it to bring out perseverance, the ability to abide under pressure. Is when things go wrong for me, I go to God and I say, Lord, please take this away from me. And the Lord says, you don't want it.
No, I don't want it.
Take it away. And the Lord says, no, I'm not. Paul three times begged God intensely to take away the thorn in the flesh. And God said, no, my grace is sufficient for you.
But Lord.
And the Lord said, no, I'm not taking it away because it brings out the ability to abide under pressure. Because while we live in this world, people, we live in a fallen world. And if today's pressure is taken away and is gone, tomorrow there's another one coming. And it may be worse. And if I can't handle this one, how am I going to handle that one? Paul says it brings about perseverance, and perseverance brings about proven character. The Bible speaks about going through through the fire like gold does. Why do they put gold through intense heat? To burn off the rubbish so that it comes out pure. You see, God is not interested in what we do. He's not interested in how loud we sing or how high we jump and praise. He's interested in how we walk. He's interested in our character, not our theology, not our religion. He's interested in our character. And we go through these circumstances together with this shepherd that I spoke about from Psalm 23. So that he can develop in me the ability to become like Jesus. Proven character. Romans 8 says that he's busy conforming us into the image of his Son. The word conform means to shape us. So Paul says our tribulations bring about perseverance, and perseverance brings about proven character, and proven character brings about hope. And if you, in your New Testament, you come across this word hope, always write in bracket the overwhelming confidence. Not in ourselves or in our abilities or in our own spirituality, but our confidence in Jesus. It brings about hope. If you ask somebody who's writing their matric and they've just finished their finals, and you said, how did it go? And he says to you, I hope I passed. Okay? That's hope against hope. But you find another character and he comes out and you ask him, how did it go? And he says, oh, I hope I passed. In other words, he's confident. As a Christian, a follower of Jesus, it's that second hope that the Bible speaks about. Because as we go through pressures and we see God doing what he's doing in our lives, it gives us confidence. It gives us the confidence that Job had. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away, blessed be the name of the Lord. Even though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And so, hope, proven character, brings about hope, because as God works us and shapes us and molds us, he makes us into people who are confident in him. And then he says, hope does not disappoint. God is faithful to his word. He's not a liar. He's not a politician. He's not a businessman who's trying to convince you into a contract or a purchase or something. Hope does not disappoint. God is absolutely good. And he's absolutely trustworthy. And he does whatever he promises he will do. And how do we know he doesn't disappoint? Because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who is given to us. In other words, God has given us someone like himself. Remember Jesus in John 14 said, I will send you a... another comforter, someone exactly like me. And how do I know God's going to do this? Because despite he has justified me, I stand in grace, I'm looking forward to heaven, but right now I have his presence with me in the Holy Spirit, who pours out God's love. And the picture that is being used here is of a flood. He has flooded our hearts with his love. And then lastly, and most importantly, in verse 11, Paul says we exalt in God. We exalt because of our spiritual position and future prospects, and we exalt in our present tribulations, but we exalt in the preeminent person of God. Our greatest delight is in Jesus. There is nothing by way of experience or possession that can match who Jesus is. We exalt in God. He's the most important thing in our lives. He's the center of our lives. He's everything in our lives. He says we exalt in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, whom we have now received. So often we Christians and the world is more interested in what God can give us than in God Himself. And our greatest joy as those who have received the gospel and benefited from its blessings is that God becomes the most important thing in our lives. And this has practical value. My marriage can only be at its best when God is the most important. If I turn my wife into being an idol, I've really got to God. If I turn my children into being an idol, I've really got to God. If I turn my business into being an idol, the most important thing in all those areas is for me to love the Lord my God with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind. And folks, for me, I often come back to this passage when I sense that I'm losing my understanding of what God has done for me. When other things become important, when circumstances become overwhelming, I go back to the gospel. Back to the cross. And I'm not ashamed. Because the love of God. That's my confession, and God's grace is teaching me more and more to live up to. When Stanton asked me to share a word with you, I really didn't know what to share. So I just went back to what I always do. Go back to the gospel that I love, that I'm not ashamed of, and what God has done for me. And I say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. I trust God will encourage you. I also trust that the Holy Spirit will challenge you. If you find that some of these areas I've been speaking about are not your experience, go to Him. Abandon your life into His hands and see what He does. And I know that my God is good and that He is faithful. Amen.